live from the Washington, D.C. area. It's the Inside Scoop, all the news that our viewers want to know. Now, here's the host.
Welcome to Inside Scoop. I'm your host, Morgan Jameson. Today, we are joined again by Mona Nguonly from PuzzleHR. We'll be talking about DEI, otherwise known as Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion. Mona, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for the opportunity, Morgan. Nice to see you again.
Always, always. Mona, what is DEI, Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion? Why are we hearing so much about it these days?
Great question. What a great way to start off. So DEI is all around us. It's in the workplace, it's in the school system, it is in healthcare, it is even in the restaurants in which we dine in these days. And we'll break it down. So diversity is the existence of differences in any environment. In the workplace, that means differences in race, gender, gender identity, sexual orientation, age, and socioeconomic classes. The more diverse the company is, the better business outcomes are because of the different voices. Now, equity is something different. Equity is the process of ensuring that policies, procedures, and programs are fair, equitable, and impartial in order to provide equal possible outcome for every person in the company. It takes into consideration that not everyone has the same starting level. And that's something we can talk about later as well, because equity isn't the same thing as being equitable. So inclusion is a sense of belonging. At work, it shows up when employees feel comfortable and supported by the company to be their authentic self. When you work in a company where no one else looks like you, acts like you, or sound like you, you start to wonder, do I really belong here? So all three have to work together in harmony, you know, throughout our workplace and where we live and where we socialize. Does that make sense?
It makes sense to me, and hopefully we can have it make a little bit more sense with our viewers as they continue along with us. So Mona, is this a new trend or topic? How long have workplaces been focusing on DEI?
Sure. So really, the workplace started doing this back in 1965 during the very first law that came into place, which was called Title VII of the Civil Rights Act of 1965. And that law made it illegal to discriminate based on race, color, religion, sex, or national origin when it comes to hiring, termination, promotion, benefits, job training, or any other terms in the workplace. And this affected companies with 15 employees or more. Now, social media has made it a lot more, they amplified it, because we're hearing about it quite a bit. During the pandemic, we heard about BLM. We were hearing about George Floyd and Breonna Taylor, and of course what happened in 2018 when Starbucks had to close all 8,000 of their locations in order to do bias training for their employees. So it's been brought to our attention in our everyday lives because of social media, but the reality is it's been around quite a bit, initially since the Civil Rights Act.
Interesting. I do remember the case with Starbucks there, which, you know, kind of makes me lead to the next question. Who's responsible for DEI?
Wow. I would have to say all of us, right? In life, all of us are responsible for that. But in the workplace, it's really the responsibility of the leadership, of the owners, of people who can make decision and drive action. And so HR is a terrific tool or department for a business owner, whether it's a large company or a small company, to lean into to talk about DEI. And it used to be that HR people were afraid of talking about DEI. It would only come up maybe once a year during anti-racism training or harassment training. And it was in the handbook and it was put there and it was left there. But these days, the conversation is everywhere. And so it's the responsibility of the leader to say, hey, we need to be a more inclusive workplace. We need to have diverse voices, and we need to bring equity so that everyone feels that they're getting paid what they're worth in the workplace.
Fantastic. So, you know, I do agree with you that it's the responsibility of everyone, and including the folks who bring it up. In your experience as an HR professional, do you include this automatically in handbooks or work that you do with people? Or, you know, if you're able to say what you are able to do and how you're able to talk to employers who are considering you as an HR representative, how you explain to them that it's important for them?
Sure. So when folks are interested in human resources and engaging in an outsourced service provider like PuzzleHR, it's because they know that something isn't right or they need help. And one of the ways that we've been helping companies while we're managing their human resources is to really understand some of the numbers, the hardcore number, the statistics of turnover, of population diversity. And when business owners want to move their business forward, they think about how do you grow people? How do you groom them? How do you do succession planning? What does that look like? And recently, PuzzleHR is very excited to roll out our DEI training, and there are different tiers of DEI. First, you've got to be aware that it is something lacking or something that needs to be worked on. And then you need to take a survey of what the current temperature is in that organization. How do the employees feel? And of course, it's got to be an anonymous survey so that employees feel they can freely speak out about it. You really can't conduct an anonymous survey when you're doing it in-house. Mm-hmm. So you should have a third party come in, assess the situation, and then come up with a plan. Is it a combination of education or reviewing policies or putting into place benefits that apply to all of the five generations that are currently in the workplace, right? Because not all of us value benefits in the same way. I care about health insurance because I've got kids and a husband, and these kids play sports, and we've got to have all sorts of insurance coverage. You might want a flexible schedule. So let's take a look at those benefits that speaks to the people who are there. And then let's take a look, how can we communicate this in our company website to go out and bring more diverse employees into the workforce?
So I want to circle back to what you said earlier when I asked you to define what DEI is. DEI is not, you know, there's a common misconception that DEI begins and ends with the discussion of race. DEI is not simply, and not to oversimplify the importance of race and understanding racism and bias in the workplace or in the world around us. However, DEI is much more inclusive and more intersectional. Can you dive into that a little bit more about the importance of a broader mindset when discussing DEI?
Sure, absolutely. And they're all equally important, right? Because diversity is the first step to bringing in different voices. Inclusion is another step, because once they're there, do they feel like they belong there? But the equity part, which is about not just treating everyone the same, equity is about knowing that not everyone has equal footing to start with. And what I mean by that is that we all have different life experiences that shapes us, where we're born, what color is our skin, what religious affiliations we belong to, possibly physical disabilities and or our sexual orientation. They're not always something that you can see, like the color of our skin. It goes deeper than that. And so equity is an area that companies need to focus on, because you can't possibly know what someone's life experiences is just by the way that they look. And if you are working in an environment where, or a company where everybody looks very homogenous and they all have the same experiences growing up, which I don't think really happens because our world is getting smaller and smaller. People are more diverse. But getting back to equity, it's making sure that even though they didn't all have the same starting point, that they can all succeed, that there are tools and there are programs that the company can roll out so that people feel there's equity in their pay. A woman shouldn't be getting paid less for doing the same job as her male counterpart. That doesn't make any sense. And so equity looks at benefits, the hiring practices, the promotions. Are these all based on giving everyone really the same opportunity to succeed? And inclusion naturally happens when we get to know our coworkers and make sure that we understand where they're coming from and to approach them with curiosity rather than ridicule and coming up with whatever our, you know, unconscious biases are. It's being aware of it. So it's really important, not just in the workplace, but everywhere else, because DEI matters.
Absolutely. So what are some of the objections that are common when you know, beginning to think about including DEI in the workplace or even implementing, you know, beyond just that first training, right? You know, what are some of those common objections and how are some ways to reframe or overcome them in order to continue to move the conversation forward? May it be employers, employees, you know, you even broaching the subject with, you know, people and say, hey, you really need to consider this. What are some of those common objections and how do you overcome them?
Sure, absolutely. First, there are some barriers to DEI. Companies don't necessarily have the financial resources, or they don't have the tools, or they don't even know where to begin. So those are some of the common objections to DEI. If it's a small company of 15 or 20 employees, chances are there isn't an HR department. So how do they even broach this with the folks that matter, which is the ownership, to decide to implement a DEI training? So to answer your question, those are the three main barriers to entry into DEI: finance, tools, and where to begin. And when you are looking at an organization that's very homogenous, one of the first things you need to consider is that not everybody is comfortable with the conversation, right? Mm-hmm. We know, we've all heard white privilege. What does that mean? I think we're understanding what that means more, but when you approach a room full of white men about DEI, their experience is going to be very different than a room full of diverse people. And so the education is the very first thing you need to talk about is, hey, understanding that we need DEI because we don't have it, or maybe we have some of it, but it's not equitable. So how do we bring it to the forefront of everyone else? We've got to approach that conversation with sensitivity and with empathy, and of course, a lot of emotional intelligence, because everyone will react differently depending again on their life experiences, how they grew up, where they came from, what biases and racisms and sexism and ageism they may have experienced up to this point in their lives. So it's not an easy topic to broach because it brings up so many emotions, but it's a great one to bring up because when you've got DEI working in a company well, it shows up in production, in the way that a diverse company outperforms those that are not.
Okay, so it sounds like every training or conversation is going to be inherent by nature different. Is that the case?
I think so, from company to company, but the idea of inclusion and equity and diversity is still the same. It's how you approach it, because you've got to know your audience, just like anything else.
Fantastic. So is DEI limited to the private sector? Are there any public entities that are currently working on it, or nonprofits, or, you know, can government contractors benefit?
every form of organization, whether you're in the private sector or in the public sector, can benefit from DEI. There's no mandate except for the Title VII, the law that we talked about at the beginning, which affects all organizations with 15 employees or more. But it is more and more a conversation that companies are having, regardless of their size and whether or not they're for profit or nonprofit. The nonprofit sector are typically the ones that don't have the financial resources, but really needs a lot of DEI. Because you think about a traditional nonprofit, you've got senior executives who's director, the executive director, typically it's someone a little older, someone of lighter skin, and then you've got everybody else working of different race, ethnicity, and they're all coming together for a common goal, whatever that nonprofit might be standing for, their mission statement. But how the people work together is very different, and nonprofits could really benefit from a DEI program. But they're usually one of the last to adopt because, again, of the finance.
So what can somebody do if they are, you know, in their workplace and they want to be more intentional about DEI? If there is no formal training, if it's not in the handbook, if an owner doesn't seem overly receptive, they can't, or they don't feel comfortable approaching, for whatever the reason is, what can an individual do to increase and improve DEI in the areas where they are able to make that impact?
Sure. So if you're not getting the buy-in from the leadership and you feel like your company can benefit from DEI, as an employee, we can be allies to one another. We could promote, support, and amplify when you hear someone of color or different appearance making a suggestion at a meeting. Instead of letting that go, compliment them, raise your hand, let them know that you think that that's a great idea, support them, because then they feel better about coming up with another idea. And it starts like that. And when they feel safe because you as a coworker make them feel that it's a good idea, then it will naturally trickle and people will feel, I can speak my mind. So it's providing a safe place, and every employee can do that.
So Mona, that's really insightful. Last time we spoke, the notion of, you know, access to technology, remote working, mm-hmm. That subject came up. Can you explain a little bit about a thread that I wanted to pull on before, the difference between equity and equal, you know, mm-hmm. as far as, I use that as an example because it's one that we talked a little bit about, but can you just help define that for folks?
Sure. So of DEI, it's important that we focus on equity, because while equality is all about treating everyone the same, equity is about knowing that not everyone has the same opportunity growing up. And what I mean by that is that all of our experiences that shapes us and allows us to have what we have today really shapes how we act, interact, and think. So going back to, you know, when the pandemic hit and children were sent home to study, we made public education available to these children to receive support and education at home. But that doesn't mean that they have the tools. So if they live in an area where, you know, they don't have Wi-Fi or it's not safe, or the children don't have a hot meal because their mother or fathers are out to work and they're pretty much left to their own, it's not equitable. And so it's difficult to create equity because they're already starting at a disadvantage. And so making up for that in the workplace or in school is to make sure that they have the support, they have the tools to really get ahead and not allow those disadvantages to really keep them from succeeding, whatever it might be. And that goes into the community, into the fabric of our neighborhoods and where we live, and just neighbors looking out for each other and making sure that the folks who are around us have access to the things that they need to have, like internet, stable internet, or a hot meal, or a computer for that matter. So equity and equality, not the same thing. It's access. Go ahead.
I was going to say, so on that notion of, you know, like a computer, what is an employer, how do they tell their employees, you know, person A is getting a take-home computer because they don't otherwise have access, whereas you do have access. You know, how does an employer explain that in a way that an employee who may or may not have ruffled feathers, but how does an employer explain that in a way to frame it as equity and not equality? Because I would imagine that many employees would say, why did they get a take-home computer? Why don't I?
Right. So this goes back to programs and policies and handbook, the very basic and foundation of HR in any company. And so if you've got two employees doing the same job, one has a computer and one doesn't, and now it's remote work, work from home or work from wherever, but not in the office. Well, in order for the employee that doesn't have a computer to do their work, they need that tool. And so the way that you explain it is to approach it from the heart and from empathy and letting the employee that does have a computer know that they could use their computer at home and the company can pay for some of that, right? Give them money back in their paycheck and give a computer to the one who doesn't have it because the person who doesn't have it can't afford it and they can't do their work. And so circumstances certainly comes into play, but making sure that you provide the tools, that doesn't mean though, Morgan, that if you've got two employees doing the same job, one has a computer at home and one doesn't, and the one who does wants a new one, well, technically as an employer, you need to make it available. Not everybody is going to be rah-rah and supportive of each other. They should be, but that's not the world that we live in. We hope that one day it can be. And so it starts with the small step, the employer making the decision to provide the computer to the one who doesn't have it at home and explaining it to the one who does that they can use theirs and get reimbursed for utilization.
So
right? Have you seen that work? Like throughout,
I believe that there are theories or places where that must have. I mean, also budgetary constraints. We need you working. Here's what you have. Here's what you don't. Like, can you make it understand? I would imagine that a lot of people, when it comes to equity, really do get caught up on the difference between equality and equity and just that what about me-ism. You know, and one of the things that I have seen in the past is, you know, thinking about kids and, you know, birthdays celebrated in school, right? A lot of kids who have summer birthdays, I'm one of them. There was just this like, all right, who's not having a birthday this week? You can bring your cupcakes and we'll celebrate you that day.
That's a great idea.
Right. And it didn't have to be on the birthday, but it was Morgan's day. Right. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I don't know if that falls more toward equity or equality, but it was definitely a way to be inclusive. And I think that even in my youth and childhood growing up, you know, that exposure to how we think about other people and how things impact them is great, but that's not the case everywhere. So, right. You know, we have a few minutes before the break, but you know, before we break, I just want to hear from you. What do you want people to stop and think before they say, what about me? What are some triggers that, you know, when we're talking about equity versus equality, what are some triggers that people might benefit from if they just pause and said, X, Y, or Z? What are some thoughts there?
That's a great question. I you kind of stumped me. I'm with you in terms of, you know, making sure that everybody feels they have a way to share whatever it is that they want to celebrate or to share an idea. But you really have stumped me, Morgan. I don't know. I think
sorry about that, Mona.
Let me think about that. That's a great one.
Sure, and I think maybe after the break, you can bring up some things, but yeah.
Yeah, I think it's all just about putting yourself in the other person's foot. I mean, in their shoes, right? Something we learned back in kindergarten. How does this affect them before you think about me? Is that something that we teach at home first or in kindergarten? Go back and think about that. But I'll give it some thought during our break.
Please do. Yeah, I'd be very curious in terms of what some triggers are that folks might be able to think of to really think less of the what about me-ism and more about the what about us collective. How does this benefit all of us? Mm-hmm. So I would really appreciate, or maybe a future segment, coming back on. We've got about 2 minutes before the break here. Mm-hmm. So I really just want to recap with folks. This first half, we've been talking with Mona Nguonly of PuzzleHR about diversity, equity, and inclusion, otherwise known as DEI. And there's a big emphasis right now on the difference between equity and equality and what that means, because not everyone comes from the same place. We also need to make sure that we have diverse relationships both in and out of the workplace and be inclusive of those around us. Mona, is there anything else you'd like to add before we wrap up this first half?
I think that one of the things employers need to be aware of is that when they're thinking about benefits, this is so near and dear to my heart. Like, we're trying to be inclusive by inviting everyone to a happy hour or offering a flexible work schedule, whatever the benefit might be. But think about the population, because not everybody could do a happy hour after work, or because they've got, little children to get home to take care of. The kids are coming off the bus, what have you.
Absolutely.
And also, the intent is good, right? But the unintended consequences makes them feel even more excluded because they can't partake in that. So think about the people that you're trying to take care of. Can you meet their needs?
Thank you for that closing thought, Mona. Folks, you have been watching Inside Scoop. I'm your host, Morgan Jameson, again, joined by Mona Nguonly of PuzzleHR. Please stick around. We'll be right back after the break.
I'll be seeing you in all the old familiar places that this heart of mine embraces all day through. I'll find you in the morning sun, and when the night is new, I'll be looking at the moon, and I'll be seeing you.
Freedom. It's at the core of who we are. The freedom to live without fear, to jog where we please, to wear a hoodie. The freedom to breathe. Before we celebrate the freedom most Americans have, we must fight for the freedom all Americans deserve. Because all lives can't matter until Black lives matter.
I'll never forget the day our landlord called and said, "Read your lease. No pets allowed." My owner tells him my dog ate the lease, but that didn't work. And now I'm stuck in a shelter, but this pit bull is ready for a new crib. I'm loving, loyal, and play well with others. So don't be intimidated by all my muscles, because the biggest one I have is my heart. That's right, I said it.
So how was work?
It was 1,300 hours. My math class from 302 was in the trenches. Davy Roth had it the worst. Fractions were coming at him left and right. He just didn't get the damn things. 2 days ago, I tried to teach him what 1/4 of 1/2 was using different sizes of blocks. Yesterday, I tried again by dividing up pizza. Both missions failed.
Oh no.
But today, I was ready. I created a combat math game where the only way to beat the enemy is to outfraction them. Davy conquered every last denominator. My game was so successful, the principal is deploying it to math squadrons all over the school.
Anywho, how was your day?
Oh, today my boss treated the office to salad wraps.
Salad wraps.
No.
Our fight against coronavirus isn't over. Let's wear face masks in public. Stay 6 feet or more from others. Follow state and local guidelines. And wash our hands frequently. Let's move forward together. Learn more at coronavirus.gov.
We're back to the Inside Scoop. Here again, your host.
Welcome back to Inside Scoop. I'm your host, Morgan Jameson. Today, we are joined by Mona Nguonly of PuzzleHR. We're talking about DEI, otherwise known as Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion. Mona, thanks for sticking around, not running away during the break.
Well, I tried, but I'm stuck to this chair, so thank you.
Well, again, thank you so much. So, Mona, when we talk about diversity, equity, and inclusion, can you give any real life examples or local examples of that around us where we can see where folks are trying to be intentional?
I think it's happening in our local government, right? We live in Fairfax County, and one Fairfax policy is a great place to look. You probably know more about it than I do, Morgan. So why don't you tell us about that? Because that's one area that's happening.
Absolutely. Yeah. So the One Fairfax policy is something that was adopted by the Board of Supervisors to take a comprehensive look about how the actions and interactions of Fairfax County impact the community. So one of the things is about how boards, authorities, and commissions, you know, those advisory groups to the Board of Supervisors are comprised and the work that they're doing and the work and how they're being intentional in the community. So I think that that's really important to have this policy here in Fairfax County. And I think it really leads the way to have that, lens to look at even signage around some of the county parks and seeing, are they saying the same thing? Are they being inclusive? Even the way those parks are designed, are they being equitable for everyone? So thank you for bringing that up, Mona. That's a really, really great local leading policy that's going on. So thank you for that.
Yeah. See, you know so much about it. Thank you.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So, Mona, when we look a little bit more internally to the workplace, what are some of the ways that we can measure if DEI is working? What are some of those considerations?
Sure. So you can measure DEI in two ways. One is the hardcore data-driven performance. And that is about, it was originally measured in financial dividends in the workplace. So there was a study done by McKinsey that showed diverse companies are more likely to financially outperform the national average by 35% for ethnic diversity and 15% for gender diversity. Diverse management teams deliver 19% higher revenues from innovation compared to those with less diverse counterparts. But there's a new ROI in DEI, and that's emerging in recent years. So there was a study done by Deloitte that shows that inclusive companies are 3 times more likely to retain millennial workers for 5+ years. That's pretty incredible because millennials tend to hop every 2 years. So 5 years is a long time. And of course, we all know that the longer a company retains an employee, the more productive and more engaged that employee is. And that's why they stay. And we also see that employees who feel included because of their diverse voices being heard are 4.6 times more likely to feel empowered to do their best for the company, even when leadership isn't around. And that says a lot. And the other one is that a company that has inclusive population are more likely to make decisions 2 times faster with half the meetings. How's that for an ROI? Wouldn't we like more time back?
When you say half the meetings, do you mean in person or Zoom, or do they just go down to emails?
This would have been before the pandemic. So it would have been in person.
Fair enough. No, I think that that's a really important stat there. to have that diverse lens and have people considering things with a diverse lens before they come to the table with solutions or opportunities, especially on that productivity side. And right. I mean, the values based there, right? Showing that first statistic that you said about McKinsey, about the amount of revenue and the profitability. But what really is hitting home with me and my generation is the length in which people are staying in the workplace. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to get into the theories about yes or otherwise, but do you think it is because of that feeling of inclusion, that openness, that ability for one to express oneself and have their ideas, or what do you think is keeping people there?
It's definitely that. It's that feeling of being valued for their opinion and for the work that they're doing. And it's just like a marriage, right? You're going to stay married much longer if you feel like your partner is appreciating you. Same thing with work. If you feel like your peers, your supervisors, people around you appreciate you for your true self, your authentic self, you're going to want to stay there because it feels safe, because it's fun to show up to work, because you care about those who care about you. So it just perpetuates that positive euphoric feeling of, believe it or not, going to work. I mean, I stayed at my previous company for 15 years, even though there wasn't diversity, but I felt included, which is kind of strange, but I did feel included and I felt valued. So 15 years is a long time to stay in one company doing, you know, sales and business development, but it happens when people feel that they are part of that voice, part of the improvement in their process or production. So yes, that that one you really can't measure as much until you take a look at your turnover rates and the longevity of certain races, certain genders in an organization. Then you start to see the trend, and companies could focus more on their recruiting effort and providing a much larger pool to go and draw from that talent. Let's not always go back to the same well, because that well has produced talent that have done well. Let's diversify. Let's take a look at maybe covering the names of the people on the application and truly just looking at their talent. What have they been able to accomplish? And then hire based on that qualification. But we're not going to forget that we're hiring just for diversity. We're hiring the best people to do the job based on what the description and the production we need out of them. So to your point, Morgan, it is important to make people feel good, because people stay where they're loved, where they're wanted, where they're appreciated.
Absolutely. No, I think that's great. And, you know, that definitely makes me think about some of the ways that some companies can internally, you know, implement some things about truly listening to those around them and being able to reflect and articulate on ideas and not just be dismissive, right? Because you don't know what somebody might say and how it might make you think or otherwise without being dismissive. So I think that's a really great first step. When we talked in the first half about, you know, possible budgetary constraints, that might be a great first step for some businesses to say, I'm going to be intentionally listening, and I'm going to be intentionally asking. So I think that that might be an interesting way to approach that. Now, what about external? How can businesses that, you know, want to but don't have the financial resources to do a full training or, you know, update their handbook or otherwise, what are some of the ways they can think externally about you know, being mindful and intentional when it comes to DEI?
Sure. And I think this goes back to something that is also very near and dear to my heart, which is emotional intelligence. You have to know how you come across when you are speaking with someone, how you're perceived because of the way that you represent yourself. And knowing that, how you approach someone else about a project or work that needs to be done, take a look around you to see what are some of the resources that are available out there, like going to hire a veteran, a disabled veteran, or hiring people by going to the Hispanic Chamber of Commerce in Washington, D.C. to do some of the project-based works that your company might have, or to hire a contractor, that would be different. That's one other way that we, each of us outside of work, when we're looking to do home improvement or looking to buy something or to engage in some sort of transaction, is look around you and see what are some of the associations around us that might have the diverse community we're looking for. Even in the restaurants, right? We live in an area where the diversity is definitely here. There's so much to, so many places we can go and eat. And now that we're opening up, there's the Ethiopian restaurants, the Vietnamese restaurants, the Chinese restaurants, the French restaurants, all these different places that we can go and visit and spend money at. That will only drive the economy. And by experiencing their culture, you can relate to them a little bit more. So when you go back to work and you see someone similar to the places that you visit, you now have a deeper understanding of what they, of where they may come from, because now culturally, you know a little bit more about them.
That is really great. Yeah, how to externally expose yourself so you have some of that. Now, when it comes to hiring and working and otherwise, are there, I'm sure, private or public funds available for being intentional with whom you are hiring or working with, or what work you are trying to do at all?
Actually, there is something called the Work Opportunity Tax Credit, WOTC, which I know that you're aware of. And when a company is hiring, they could see that maybe hire from a disadvantaged zip code or opening up in an office in an economically depressed neighborhood. And that way the company gets a tax credit, a tax incentive. Or when you hire a veteran, you also get a tax incentive. Or if you hire someone who's been unemployed for a long period of time, you're helping that unemployed person out and you're helping yourself out because you're getting the work opportunity tax credit. So that's one way to, help someone else while helping yourself out. Is that what you mean?
Yeah, that's fantastic. What about some resources? Where can people go to learn about some of those things or about this topic in general? What are some resources that you might point people to?
Well, hello, you can always contact PuzzleHR. You can call me directly or you can send me an email, mona@puzzlehr.com. I'm always interested in having these great conversations because you just never know where it's going to lead. And it starts with just really being open to the discussion of DEI. What does it look like? What does it mean? How do we measure it? How do we come in without scaring off the current population? Because the changes can't be too abrupt. It's got to be subtle. It's got to be intentional. And it's got to be done intelligently, because you could certainly lose some really good people if you don't bring this up the right way. So you can go to puzzlehr.com to check us out. You can go to the One Fairfax policy. You can also, if you're a nonprofit and you don't have the financial resources, we're putting up right now the website where you can go and apply for grants so that you can adopt a DEI policy and practice.
That's fantastic. A real true giving back for those who don't have the equity to take on that opportunity. So, Moni, I want to circle back a little bit to what you were saying about looking at the resources around us and not going back to the same pools. Mm-hmm. Where does that really begin? Where does it begin when looking for talent pools and, you know, not getting the same carbon copy of the person you had before?
Right. So it begins with an intentional recruiting effort. If you have an internal recruiter, that recruiter needs to expand their scope of where they go to get the talent. That starts with maybe not going back to the same colleges always to get the recruits for the internships, but trying out local schools or inner city schools to give inner city kids an opportunity. It also starts with reaching out to communities and chambers of commerce, like the Asian American Chamber of Commerce, the Hispanic Chamber of Commerce. Those are some resources that you could reach out to see who there might be a good fit for the openings that you have. And of course, you can hire a veteran. And there is a lot of applicant tracking websites and tools and places to go to and ask them for advice. And how do I rewrite either my job description or make this more open? Because sometimes you might say, I want someone with 5 years of accounting experience for this controller position, and they've got to learn, they've got to do QuickBooks. But do you really need them to have 5 years? Could it be 3.5 years? Could your job description be more flexible? Because sometimes we put it in our head that this is a must, but let's really evaluate those skills or that experience and how it can open up a much wider applicant pool without having to really lower your standard, because we don't want to do that. We just want to make it a bigger opportunity pool for the candidates and the recruits.
Fantastic. Yeah, no, I one of the things that I have seen recently is education requirements. Do they really need to have a master's or a bachelor's, or, you know, what's that life experience? Maybe they've been in that field for 15 years, but they don't have a piece of paper that says that they are on, you know, qualified for it, but they're the most qualified out there. So, you know, that's one of the things I've seen. Back to internships. Okay. Back to internships. You mentioned, you know, not going back to the same places. I recall not too long ago, and there's a really great organization out there called PayR Interns. That in and of itself is something that I think falls within the scope of equity. Not everybody can afford to take on an unpaid internship because, frankly, experience does not pay rent.
That is so true. That hits home the equity side, right? Mm-hmm. The kids who are from inner cities or with less financial stability, they need summer jobs. And those summer jobs are probably helping to pay for some of their books and college tuition. So they can't afford to do the internship. So maybe there needs to be some more thought, more intentional thought from the academia world about making a summer job part of that internship and paying these folks for it, and not just saying, oh, now you can put our company internship on your resume to make you more marketable. But is it equitable?
Right. And you know, it definitely shows the privilege that you are able to go work for experience, which, not knocking on experience by any means, but, you know, sure, at the end of the day, you can't eat experience. You know, that's there. I want to go back a little bit more to the data and statistics that you mentioned, because I jotted down a few of these. When these stats have been done, I know that there have been studies forever and ages, including what you mentioned, you know, blurring out the names on resumes and otherwise. Are there any statistics that jump out at you or have been redone recently that people might have had something, a notion in their mind, and it's recently been reevaluated? What are some of the ones that really speak to you?
So one that was done, and I can't remember the name of the organization that did this. It might have been Deloitte or McKinsey. But it said that employees in highly diverse and inclusive organizations show 26% more team collaboration and 18% more team commitment than those of non-inclusive companies. And it's kind of silly that we would need this statistic to tell us what we already know, which is if you like the people that you work with, you tend to get better results. And the only way you're really going to like the people you work with is that you get to know them on a personal level, that you don't judge them because they show up at work wearing different clothes than you, or head covering, or they observe a different religious holiday than you. Quite frankly, having grown up, you know, poor and also in a predominantly Black neighborhood where there were a lot of Hispanics and other Asians. It was the only place that we could learn that we could live because my folks were immigrants. I just remember that my summers were amazing because I got to taste different types of foods from my neighbors who were Filipinos and Ethiopian. And I learned different cultures. I learned about Jehovah Witnesses, why they believe what they believe, because one of my good friend was a Jehovah Witness. You'd never know it by looking at the way she dresses, but her religion helped shape who she is and what she does today. So I think that it is such a simple concept of having an internal clock or will to try and seek and understand the differences in each other, because that will only make us more interesting, great conversation pieces, more empathetic, and better managers, quite frankly. Good leaders tend to have had quite a bit of experience, not just culturally, but socioeconomically, because they understand the perspective. So I would say that one really speaks to me.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that and providing more insight on, you know, your passion and understanding toward this. It definitely also speaks to, you know, this isn't a new thing. As you mentioned, this goes back to the 1965 Title VII Civil Rights Act and all of that that goes into it. But, you know, this cultural nuance here, the phrase, you can't teach an old dog new tricks, I think it's possible, but I definitely think from what you just said, that exposure at a younger age, parents, caretakers, others who are watching at this moment, expose those around you to some things. I think what Mona said, go try out different food, because you don't know when you might cross somebody. It doesn't have to be somebody at the workplace, but, you know, go to a cultural festival. We have so many available here in Northern Virginia and our community around us. Mm-hmm. Mona, we've got a few minutes left, and I kind of want to wrap with the question of, why does it matter? If you want people to walk away from this segment and understand, why does DEI, diversity, equity, inclusion, matter?
Yeah, it matters. Diversity, equity, and inclusion matters. So from the business world, it matters because companies that value DEI are stronger, more profitable than those who don't value DEI. It increases job satisfaction, increases tenure, increases productivity. And as importantly, it matters because our humanity matters. We've seen the last several years of divisive politics, of the things that have led to BLM. So our ability to relate to one another and acknowledge our differences and appreciate it and use it to grow our worldviews and expand our experiences, making us more empathetic and increase our emotional intelligence. I keep coming back to emotional intelligence, but I think sometimes we don't give that enough value in our workplace. Emotional intelligence is the very first step in DEI, recognizing, understanding your strengths and your weaknesses, and where you go from there. Our lived differences fuel our innovation, which fuels our ability to be aware of our unconscious biases. We all have unconscious biases. We can't help it because we're human. And so that can shape our actions, which may create unintentional consequences. Sometimes the microaggressions, and I've experienced it myself, where people have asked me or made the comment, oh my gosh, you are so eloquent in your speech. You speak perfect English. And I'm thinking, well, why wouldn't I? I've been in this country for over 40 years. I was schooled here and worked here. And just because I look different doesn't make me different, but I am different. And I want people to appreciate all of our differences because it just makes life a lot more interesting. And don't we all want our children to grow up in a world where we're not fighting wars because of our color or our religious differences? But let's appreciate that. It makes everything so much more interesting. And it allows people to be authentic with their true selves And we can all learn from that, because the minute you stop learning and growing, it's no good. So it does matter from my personal viewpoint, and also from professional development. Thank you for asking that question, Morgan.
Absolutely. No. And thank you for once again sharing and opening up. I think one of the things that we need to remind folks, and I'm going to take a moment to use the platform here. America is a melting pot. America is a place where people come together, and it is a sharing and convergence of ideas and thoughts, and just our community as a whole. Fairfax County is one of the most diverse counties. Yes, it might be on paper wealthy, but we have people at the exact opposite end of the spectrum. But we have more languages spoken in our school system than many other school systems out there. We live in a diverse community. We need to take advantage of it, and we need to seize it and see that this really is that American dream, that the sharing of ideas is important. And, you know, Mona, again, thank you for sharing some of your experiences and what you've gone through. And hopefully, again, people who are watching, take that opportunity to be more intentional, to be thoughtful, and everything else. Mona, we've got about a minute or so left. Any other closing thoughts or I mean, feel free. I know people need to go to PuzzleHR's website, but any other closing thoughts before
sure.
we wrap up?
I'm pretty open about my background, but I wanted to share something that is super special. And that is, you know, back in 1975, when we left Cambodia, my parents put down on the papers that we want to come to America because America is the land of opportunity. And America is the place where my parents could bring all six of us up, and we can all be what we choose to be. And when we first came here, we ended up in Medford, Oregon, and the church that took us in was lovely and clothed us and fed us and put us in school to learn English. And they did all that they could to make us feel welcome. But ultimately, there was a much deeper hunger for my parents to experience more diversity. And my dad, who was the only member who spoke English in our family, decided that it was going to be here in Fairfax County. So with less than $3,000 in 1975, he moved six kids between the ages of 9 to 2 years old and his wife to Fairfax County, worked three different jobs so we can all go to school.
That's
and
beautiful.
He chose this county because of the opportunity and the people that are here. So I'm really blessed to be living here in Fairfax County.
Thank you, Mona, for sharing. Again, I'm Morgan Jameson, your host for Inside Scoop. Thank you for joining. We were joined with Mona Nguonly of PuzzleHR. I'm sure we'll have her back again. I hope you enjoyed this segment on diversity, equity, and inclusion.